Steve Kerr's family story is odd, horrendous at times, and then also triumphant in the end. So why are we going to show you this from Google Maps? It's because this is where Steve Kerr is from. Yeah, I know. Craig RPA, who's a humongous basketball fan, even jumped a little bit as he saw that. Now, the reason that we show that, if we could put it up one more time, is because that is where Steve Kerr is from. Let's go all the way back to his grandfather, whose name you're going to see right here is Stanley Kerr. I was looking for any sort of similarities, by the way, just facially, I don't see it, but continuing on. Stanley and Elsa Kerr, his wife, were American missionaries who met in the Middle East after World War I. Stanley worked for an American Near East relief in Turkey during the slaughter of countless Armenians, detailed later in his memoir, The Lions of Marash. She had traveled to study Turkish and to teach. They married in 1921, moved to Lebanon to run orphanages. They went on to teach at the American University of Beirut for 40 years. Now, this is going to be a very important point. Is the university, American University of Beirut, throughout this story, it's going to be labeled UAB. It is not University of Alabama, Birmingham. It is very far from it, although neither team does have a football team. UAB came back recently, though. So now we move forward to Steve Kerr's then grandfather, now father, and the son of Stanley Kerr, Malcolm Kerr, who is seen in those three photos right there. The facial similarities are starting to align. So that was when a 19-year-old student from Occidental College, his wife Ann Zwicker, persuaded her parents with the assistance of the family minister to go study at AUB, the Harvard of the Middle East. Now, as they sort of showed it and displayed it through many articles, was that this university was gorgeous. Like, it is on the beach, it's like this thriving metropolitan area. They would have four kids, would Anne and Malcolm and Steve Kerr. If you're looking in the top left picture, he is the little tyke on top of the van. If you are looking top right, he is the one who has insanely blonde hair. And you could probably see bottom left as well, which one Steve Kerr is. So then here's where we go next. The Kerrs lived all over the world while their children were growing up in Beirut, is what the Tampa Bay Times would write. So he was a world traveler, traveling to Beirut, Cairo, Oxford, South of France, Tunisia, and Los Angeles. And as he went on to say, my first memories are of wanting to play basketball. Malcolm Kerr, by the way, as you're seeing on the bottom there, was on the UCLA faculty for 20 years. So how exactly did someone like Steve Kerr end up in Beirut, go to LA, and then go back? Here's exactly how it occurred. In 1982, Malcolm, Steve Kerr's father, was offered the presidency at this university. We knew the offer was coming, said Anne. It was only a matter of time. Malcolm was so right for the job. Now, Denise, if you are looking at this and right, you are the son or even a child of your dad, and he has this dream of becoming a president of a university, mm-hmm, and a thriving university that is outside of America, me personally, I'd be terrified.
Right, I'd be terrified. But then also, I guess it just depends. We don't really know the type of person and maybe character that his father was. So it's also, that's something to keep in mind. Because if right, if I come from, like, my family is very inspiring. My mom is very inspiring. So if my mom was to move, whether it be like halfway across the world or just like a really rare job, she'd find a way to communicate that with me where it just makes sense. Like, it's right, just gonna be the grandest time. It's gonna be amazing.
The grandest time.
Right, it's gonna be amazing. So I don't know how his dad presented it. Maybe uh-huh, that's what could have removed some of the fear. Of course, it's gonna be just the whole, like, him having a, how he's gonna move. Maybe he has aspirations and mm-hmm, now they're detoured. But I think, I'm curious to see how his dad presented that to him because totally, he's a great speaker. And I'm sure some of that came from his upbringing.
Yes, very much so. It ran in their blood. Now, here's the other huge point about this, is that whenever we're talking about the Middle East, what mm-hmm, are we talking about? Tough times.
Right.
Bloodshed. And here is what occurred right before Malcolm Kerr was offered the presidency job. He was kept in New York until things settled. Why? Because the university's acting president, David Dodge, was kidnapped in July and thus they were in need of leadership. Here is Malcolm Kerr with his wife and all of their children. Malcolm Kerr, obviously in the middle, and Kerr to our left, his right. Here's what occurred next via John Branch. He, as in Malcolm, accepted the job the next morning. And this is also very important. The Israeli invasion of Lebanon and the countermove by the Iranians to send its Iranian Revolutionary Guards there through Syria began in June 1982, weeks before Malcolm Kerr was to start the job. In the chaos, Iran-backed militants were organizing and would eventually become Hezbollah, as we certainly all do know. He takes the job, and obviously on the left, Yasser Arafat on the right. Very surprising, I know. And that was in 1993, later to be published, of course, in 1993. Now, let's get to this. Let's focus on Steve for just a moment. While Malcolm was in Beirut accepting this job, Steve Kerr, like me, did not get any D1 offers. And his basketball was good, it just wasn't good enough. And here's what the Tampa Bay Times wrote. The scouting services all had me listed as being too slow, said Steve. Gonzaga was interested, but he had to play against some guy named John Effing Stockton. For 2 hours. I didn't do very well, said Steve. When it was over, the coach, Jay Hillock, said to me, it wouldn't be a problem if you were a step slow, but you were 2 steps slow. My God. I mean, I get it. Like, recruiters are tough, but this is like really tough, right?
This is like kind of almost below the belt. You could say, like, you're not just slow, you're super friggin' slow.
Right.
Which is pretty funny.
Right. And John Stockton, by the way, was not slow. One of the best point guards that we've ever seen. I remember real quick when I was trying out, which obviously I didn't make. I was 4'11 going into high school. And I know, shocking. And I had to go up against a kid who played starting point guard for our junior high team for 3 straight years. And he intentionally dicked me by going in front of me in the one-on-one line so he could D up against me.
You played, you went up against an underclassman and lost?
No. He was in my class. He was in my class.
Oh, okay.
I was just tiny. I was 4'11 going into high school. In the tryout, he's like, oh, easy, and goes right in front of me and just dicks me over. So I understand how you feel, Steve Kerr. So on top of this, here's what others wrote. Bright, articulate kid who's recruited, next one. Bright, articulate kid. Thank you. Who's recruited by no one, winds up in Arizona, barely that is, for the school, seems to hedge on offering its last scholarship. They were 4-24.
Yeah, that's awful.
Now, awful. And this is a team that Lute Olson took over. We all know Lute Olson. Mm-hmm. Lute Olson is a basketball Hall of Fame, great coach. Inherited a program that was broken at University of Arizona. And here is the first of many videos that we are going to show you, which is Lute Olson discussing Steve Kerr's recruitment and a young Steve Kerr talking about said recruitment.
Coming out of high school, he didn't have a single scholarship offer. But Lute Olson, in his first year at Arizona, was trying to rebuild a crippled program. So he gave Kerr a chance.
We were in dire need of a shooter.
I was just going to be a regular college student and applied to different schools. And luckily, Coach Olson came in at the last second and offered me a scholarship.
He did. And thus, Steve Kerr was then accepted into the University of Arizona West. He looks like a beautiful man, by the way.
He's such a beautiful man.
Can we acknowledge the sitch here? I mean, jeez, think he had any problems with, girls? Wow.
Good stuff.
Yes, very much so.
Good stuff.
I mean, look, he's a beautiful man. I get it. Beautiful man. Here's where we take another turn. So Malcolm Kerr is in Beirut. As we already established, Steve Kerr would go back and forth, and here's what he outlined when he was on vacation. On the day he was supposed to leave Beirut, sitting in the terminal with his mom, the shelling around the airport intensified. Finally, their driver told them there was no chance to get out of Beirut that day and drove them from the airport back to safety of the U.S. Embassy. Now, let's go to the next one, and then we'll come back. There was some question about whether flights would be going out because of everything that was happening. We were in the terminal and all of a sudden there was a blast. It wasn't in the terminal, but on the runways. The whole place just froze. Everybody just froze. People started gathering saying, we've got to get the hell out of here. My mom grabbed me and I remember running out of the terminal through the parking lot. It was really scary. I remember thinking, this is real. Yeah, this is what's potentially gonna happen if you're in the Middle East, especially in Beirut in war-torn times. Now to go back to what we just showed you, which is our next one. 2 days later, the same driver took her on a terrifying 8-hour car ride through Syria. to Georgia. From there, he flew to Tucson to start his college career. You know, no big deal. A very big deal is the last paragraph. Later, Kerr learned that his driver had been killed by a sniper shortly after their ride through Syria. My gosh. Except it would not end there for Steve Kerr. And as we would learn, and he would learn, this is via the New York Times in October of 1983. Front page cover of what occurred at the airport and many other places. Beirut death toll at 161 Americans. French casualties rise in the bombings. A truck bomb destroyed the four-story Marine barracks. Steve Kerr was in the thick of that, along with many others, and then managed to get out. So he goes to Arizona. Here's the beautiful man that is Steve Kerr, via the Arizona Daily Star, making some sort of move that unfortunately I can't do with my ankle anymore. And thanks for the courtesy laugh. So on a serious note, Steve Kerr would unfortunately suffer even more trialing times, as you're going to see in this next video. I believe this is via ABC News. This was a humongous story in the 80s, and it involved Malcolm Kerr, Steve Kerr's dad.
Malcolm Kerr, the president of American University in Beirut, was gunned down in his school today, the latest victim of Lebanon's seemingly endless violence.
Steve's father, Malcolm, who was as passionate about Middle Eastern affairs as his third child was about basketball, had been gunned down in a wave of anti-American sentiment. It was January 18th, 1984, and halfway around the world, in Tucson, Steve, then a freshman at the University of Arizona, heard the news.
So, Malcolm Kerr, as you heard from both news reports, was shot and killed. Steve Kerr's dad, the New York Times even wrote about this. Malcolm Kerr, who was 52 at the time, had stepped off the elevator. Let's go back for just a second. Malcolm Kerr, 52, had stepped off the elevator toward his office in College Hall and was shot in the back of the head. The two unknown assailants escaped. A group calling itself Islamic Holy War took responsibility later that day. It was later determined that Hezbollah had taken the life of Malcolm Kerr. It was front page news, of course, on the New York Times as well. As you're going to see to the right, university head killed in Beirut, gunman escaped. John Branch continues, Ann Kerr learned about it while waiting at a campus guardhouse out of the rain for a friend. She ran to College Hall. Remember, real quick, this is how it was. There was no cell phones, there was no internet. Mm-hmm. There was still snail mail that was going on. So she heard about it, and as we'll continue, ran to College Hall to the second floor where she found her husband lying on the floor, face down, his briefcase and umbrella in front of him. She wrote in her memoir, "Come with me from Lebanon." So this is, again, another death that occurred in Steve Kerr's close circle, went from his driver and now his father, who were both killed by militants. Now, Denise played college ball. I did not. We all react to death a little bit differently. I can't imagine how anyone would react. It's different strokes for different folks and what you'd want to do. As I'm going to get into in a second and show you, Steve Kerr continued playing to honor his father. But just reacting to all of this, that takes sheer determination and gut to continue your college career to honor one of your loved ones.
Yeah, it definitely takes a lot. And I feel like because he was basically by himself in the States, I think he had to find a way to cope. And maybe basketball is the only thing that he shared with his father, or one of the biggest things that he shared with his father. And that was the closest that he was going to keep him to him, right. You know, and it's so unfortunate. And the loss of a parent is extremely tough, but to hear about how exactly they passed in such a just disgusting way is even more hurtful. And I feel like for his own good, it was the best decision he could have made to continue playing the way that he did and, you know, succeed in the way that he did. Because, you know, you have to keep in mind, like sometimes we don't take into account what we have. Right? Like it takes a big loss to recognize what you have. It takes a huge hindering in your journey to really recognize what you have to lose. And in Steve's case, unfortunately, it was his father. And that's really what motivated him to get to where he is. That was the fire that constantly stayed with him. And, you know, it's tough, man. But sports, just activities overall, sometimes they serve as placeholders for our loved ones.
Like, great point.
You know, especially when you move out in college is the best way. You make new friends, you make new family, and maybe his teammates were his family.
Very much so. And as you are all going to see right here, here's what Steve Kerr had to say. For the next 2 days, the only escape from his grief came on the basketball court, like Denise alluded to. Here's the quote. "It was the only thing to do," he said. "My dad had more to do with my being a basketball player and being in Arizona than anyone," is what he would say. And then here's where it takes another horrible turn. I understand that these are college kids. I understand that kids are gonna heckle other kids. It should never get to this level, at least you would hope. But when Arizona traveled to Arizona State in Tempe, Arizona, Tucson to Tempe, I understand it's a bit of rivalry as well. But here is what occurred when Steve Kerr was playing against Arizona State.
The whole game, I was thinking of my dad, and I had dedicated the game to him privately.
Playing on the floor of their arch rival Arizona State, Kerr heard the unthinkable coming from the crowd.
There were about 10 or 12 students yelling, you know, "Where's your father?" I rarely have a vindictive thought in my mind when I'm playing basketball, but that was probably the one game where I did, and I've never seen anything like it.
That was one of many things, by the way, that the Arizona State fans chanted at Steve Kerr. Another, "Where's your father?" was one. Another is, "Go join the Marines." Go back to Beirut. I mean, like, horrible things, deplorable things. Here's what Steve Kerr said on the record via the New York Times. "When I heard it," as in what we just shadowed, or outlined rather, "I just dropped the ball and started shaking. I sat down for a minute. I'll admit they got to me. I had tears in my eyes. For one thing, it brought back memories of my dad. But for another thing, it was just sad that people would do something like that." And I totally understand where he's coming from, of course. How could you not? So Steve Kerr then continued on his own career. And in the 1988 draft, a little comical here, Steve Kerr was picked number 50. I know that the draft has shrunken. In the years past, wasn't it like 12 rounds or 10 rounds? Like, it was way up there in the double digits. That's why Steve Kerr was picked number 50. I wanted to outline, by the way, that Dan Majerle was in this draft.
No.
We see this so many times. We're gonna pivot away just for a second. There's so many times where we hear like LeBron stopper,
right?
Jordan stopper. Like, Dan Majerle was supposed to be the Jordan stopper.
Right.
Okay, hilarity. And then Steve Kerr was picked number 50 by the Phoenix Suns. In his NBA career, he was fantastic. And he carried everything that occurred previously in his life with him. He was a five-time winner, combining seasons with the Chicago Bulls and the San Antonio Spurs. With the Bulls, of course, at one point in time, we could make this another story, even he got punched in the face by Michael Jordan, but still it proved something to MJ. It seemed like he always wanted to prove a lot of people wrong throughout his career. As a coach, he has won 3 times, and that has been with the Golden State Warriors. His career free throw percentage is above 86. And most importantly, if we could throw this up again, he still holds this record, even though he is coaching arguably the greatest backcourt that we have ever seen. Still holds the record for career three-point percentage at 45.4. And by the way, let me ask you a question real quick. So back in those days of when Steve Kerr played, he only got a few amount of shots.
Right.
Like, he wasn't taking 9 threes, 12 threes like Steph and Clay take. So I think it shows even more that he wasn't getting the volume of looks. And when he shot them, he had to make them in order to solidify that record, right? So it's even more impressive.
No, it's very impressive. And I think, again, it just goes back to just like all the baggage that he was carrying. I think you hit it right on the dot. Like, he constantly had to prove something to somebody. And I feel like when you're walking around with that chip on your shoulder, even though he's not getting the looks, he's still fighting to get those looks. And it drove him to you know, really bring out this hunger. And I mean, the baggage that he's carrying definitely added to the character, the strength that he has. And there was one quote on the New York Times article that really stood out for me. And it's like, just put yourself in someone else's shoes and look at it from a bigger perspective. I think you can apply that to basketball. You can apply that to just overall life.
Right.
Because he was able to really, he could have easily said, first off, in that game with Arizona State, he could have easily, like, reacted, right? But he recognized he had to grow up fast, and he recognized that he's not only representing himself but the organization. I feel like sometimes as athletes and entertainers, like, you don't recognize how much responsibility you have. So he grew up in that part very early, and then just referencing the quote again, and putting himself in someone else's shoes, like, he, rather than be angry, he said, you know, I'm sad that people would react this way. Like, yeah. He was hurt that people were hurt. That was like a really high.
That was high. I mean.
He was hurt. He was hurt not necessarily because of what they were telling him, but because as a whole, you know, these fans disappointed him.
Yeah.
God knows what they were hurting from. The game should never be that competitive. But I think he empathized in the best way. I know myself, if I were to undergo something like that in college, I'd probably like go meta world peace
I
or something.
Took the words
just,
out of
like,
my mouth.
Be very aggressive. And he humbled himself.
Totally.
The best way.
Completely humbled himself. And he was able to have what is, by any stretch of the imagination, an incredibly successful career.
Yeah.
I mean, his points per game weren't high, as you're gonna see right here, with every team that he's been on. I mean, they were never above 8. Yet still, he was a contributing factor to many championship teams because he was reliable offensively and somewhat defensively. Now, back in Beirut, there is a grave marker and memorial for Malcolm H. Kerr, as you're gonna see right here, again, via the New York Times. It is at the American University of Beirut. There is also this, a banyan tree at the site where Malcolm H. Kerr's ashes are buried at the university. He is said to have carved his initials into the tree as a youth. Incredible. Now, there are some who are gonna be watching this video and saying, well, Steve Kerr is super political, where he said stuff like this, 90% of our country wants background checks on gun purchases and we've gotta go to our Senate, our House, voting it down, using the Bill of Rights, onward and onward. There is a context for all of this. Mm-hmm. There is a reason why he has become incredibly political. There's a reason he has called out President Trump. There is a reason why he has backed the Philadelphia Eagles and many others when President Trump decided to disinvite them. Mm-hmm. Disinvite them from the White House. It is because he has been a world traveler. Mm-hmm. He has seen the world outside of the United States, how our government has failed us at times. And if you go to his timeline, you will see all of this. And you could follow him at Steve Kerr. More importantly, what I wanted to point out is an incredibly tragic story that Steve Kerr has. And mainly, there is a reason why he has such a unique perspective on many things inside and outside of basketball. Right. Many would attribute that to, and I don't blame him for it, but playing under and then being with mainly Greg Popovich mm-hmm. for a very, very long time. But it's way more than that.
Right.
So Steve Kerr, unbelievable story. Unfortunately, tragedy at the same time. But really, I think we're on the same page here to wrap this up, which is what I see most in Steve Kerr is the perseverance.
Yeah.
The straight perseverance that he has dealt with so much loss in his life and has been able to overcome that. And it seems like basketball was used as a vehicle to just try and aid him to have the right state of mind. And it's amazing what sports can do.
Yeah, man, he's a resilient man.
Very much so. If you made it to the end of this video, mazel tov. If you want to see more, hit the bell and hit subscribe. Why don't you?